भगवते वासुदेवाय ओम नमो भगवते वासुदेवाय ओम नमो भगवते वासुदेवाय। सो वी आर रीडिंग फ्रॉम श्रीमद् भागवतम कैंटो फर्स्ट चैप्टर 16 हाउ महाराज परीक्षित रिसीव द एज ऑफ कली। टेक्स्ट 25 धरणी उवाच भवान् हि वेद तत्सर्वं यन्मां धर्मानुपृच्छसि चतुर्भिर्वर्तसे येन पादैर्लोकसुखावहैः। ट्रांसलेशन: द अर्थली डेटी इन द फॉर्म ऑफ अ काउ दस रिप्लाई टू द पर्सनैलिटी ऑफ रिलीजियस प्रिंसिपल्स इन द फॉर्म ऑफ अ बुल। ओ धर्म, वॉट एवर यू हैव इंक्वायर्ड फ्रॉम मी शैल बी नोन टू यू। आई शैल ट्राई टू रिप्लाई टू ऑल दोज क्वेश्चंस वंस यू टू वेयर मेंटेन्ड बाय योर फोर लेग्स एंड यू इंक्रीज्ड हैप्पीनेस ऑल ओवर द यूनिवर्स बाय द मर्सी ऑफ द लॉर्ड। Purport: The principles of religion are laid down by the Lord Himself, and the executor of such laws is Dharmaraj. Such principles of work fully in the age of Satya Yuga. In the Treta Yuga, they are reduced by a fraction of 1/4. In Dwapar Yuga, they are reduced to 1/2. And in Kali Yuga, they are reduced to 1/4. Gradually diminishing to the zero point, and then devastation take place. Happiness in the world depends proportionately on the maintenance of religious principles, individually or collectively. The best part of valor is to maintain the principles despite all kinds of odds. Thus one can be happy during the span of life and ultimately return to Godhead. Hare Krishna. So we welcome everyone for studying Srimad Bhagavatam. This chapter, how Parikshit received the age of Kali, has nothing to do between Parikshit and Kali. It has all to do between Dharma and Dharani. How Dharma and Dharani, the bull and the cow, are talking to each other about the current state of affairs for each of them. In Marathi they say kasa kay patil barahay ka. So they are not talking in that tone. Like typically people in this world, they ask each other's welfare. But when great personalities meet, they talk about welfare in terms of Krishna consciousness and how the other person is able to execute the will of the Lord in this world. That is real self-welfare. And that is the difference between their discussion and mundane discussions. There are people who send how are yous, you know, to each other very regularly. And the typical answer is fine. I am being fined by material energy for my existence in this material world. So we studied in the previous section, Dharma asked many questions. O earth, are you lamenting for a loss of a friend? Are you lamenting for my state of affairs? Are you lamenting for yourself, demigods, living entities? Are you lamenting for women who are unprotected by their husbands, children who are not taken care of by parents, goddess of learning being mishandled? Are you lamenting for Brahmana's conditions, administration of the universe, people in general? Or are you lamenting because of Lord's absence from your surface? So in this way he asked many, many questions. And these questions in and of themselves indicate that he already knew why she is lamenting. He's asking in the form of a question. And therefore in this verse, Dharani says, Bhavan hi veda tat sarvam. You already know, O Dharma, yan mam dharma anupruchasi, whatever you have inquired from me one after another, you already know. But still, because you asked me, I will still try to answer your questions. Chaturbhir vartase yena padai loka sukhavahai. What is your glory, O Dharma? When you stand on your four legs very firmly, you give great happiness to the whole creation. When you are maintained with your four legs properly, you increase happiness all over the universe by the mercy of the Lord. That is your speciality. And purport has many important points. Dharmam tu sakshat bhagavat pranitam. Principles of religion are enunciated by the Lord Himself. And how they are established in the beginning of Satya Yuga fully, and they gradually diminish till Kali Yuga. At the end of Kali Yuga, it becomes practically zero, and then devastation takes place, partial annihilation. So Prabhupada gives the conclusion: happiness in the world depends proportionately on the maintenance of religious principles, individually or collectively. So Shruti, Smriti, Puran, Adi. Then comes additionally Pancharatrikim Vidhim Vina. So there are four: Shruti, Smriti, Purana, and Pancharatra Vidhi. Aikantiki Harer Bhakti Utpata Yeva Kalpate. If one practices bhakti without reference to these four, he concocts that for me this is going to be my bhakti. Utpata Yeva Kalpate. So even for devotees, there will be great distress in their life if they don't follow the religious principles. Although in the name of Sarva Dharman Parityajya Krishnaikam Sharanam Raja, we may tend to justify that I am abandoning all varieties of religion to surrender to Krishna. But if you are not on that pure spiritual platform, we will actually undergo unhappiness in our life. The best part of valor is to maintain the principles despite all kinds of odds. So we say in the life of Pandavas, all kinds of odds, that too from very people of their own family, not from outside. In fact, many outsiders were willing to help Pandavas, but their own family members were deadly against them. But despite all kinds of odds, they always maintained principles. Thus one can be happy during the span of life and ultimately return to Godhead. That is the result of being Dharma Parayana. So if we maintain Dharma, we are maintained by Dharma. Dharmo Rakshati Rakshataha. Dharmo, what is that? Gnata Hatam Hanti Dharmo Rakshati Rakshataha. If someone tries to kill Dharma, he is killed by Dharma. And if someone tries to protect Dharma, he is protected by Dharma. So the Dharma Shabda comes from Dhatu Dhru, Dharayati, that which sustains the very existence of something is called Dhru, Dharma. So if that is removed, then everything crumbles. So that is the meaning of Dharma. Dhru, Dhru. So, there are two kinds of dharma. There is swadharma and nitya dharma. So, swadharma refers to our conditional duties given in the Vedas, and nitya dharma refers to our constitutional duties given in the Vedas. So, it is our duty to know our duty. Sometimes people say, well, you know, if I don't know and if I committed some wrong, I shouldn't be punished for that. But if you are in a system, the laws that govern that system, you have the onus on you to know them. So therefore there are operations manuals given for the creation in the form of Vedas. was recently studying Manu Samhita. Let me see if I can. So there is a description of actions of mind, speech and body, how they produce the conditions of men that they currently exist in. Actions which spring from the mind, from speech and from the body produce either good or
and there are total three kinds or three locations.
There are activities that fall under 10 heads. So now it talks about three kind sinful mental actions, sinful speech and sinful bodily actions, and then gives the result of committing these sins for human beings. Coveting the property of others. Can we pull down that? I didn't see it. You're all quite cool about just pull down the. Okay, thank you. Coveting the property of others, thinking in one's heart of what is undesirable, and adherence to false doctrines are the three kinds of sinful mental action. Okay, coveting others' property, undesirable thought, adherence to false doctrines. Then, four kinds of evil verbal action. Abusing others, speaking untruth, criticizing, which means detracting from merits of all men, and idle talk shall be the four kinds of evil verbal actions. Then comes three kinds of wicked bodily actions. Taking what has not been given to you. Like sometimes we use others' chappal or some, you know. Injuring creatures without the sanction of the law. So himsa that is unjustified by the scripture. And holding criminal intercourse with another man's wife are declared to be the three kinds of wicked bodily actions. Now, the consequence. A man obtains the result of good or evil mental, verbal and speech actions in his. So, evil mental actions result is on the mind. Evil speech action is on the speech, evil bodily action is on the body. The results of sin come on them. In consequence of many sinful acts committed with his body, a man becomes in his next birth something inanimate, like a plant. So he becomes inanimate. In consequence of sins committed by speech, he becomes a bird or a beast. Speech is not there. A very terrible kind of communication. In consequence of mental sins, he becomes reborn in a low caste. He is born as a chandala, you know, antyaja, they call lower castes in life. So anyways, so one is supposed to become tridanda. Tridanda means one who gives three disciplines to one's body, mind and speech. One has to become extremely careful in how one engages in these three activities. So this is just an example of how dharma affects our happiness and distress. So this is Manu Samhita 12.9. Now the next verse, same. Saying mental is on the higher level. As far as Bhrigu and Vishnu's pastime goes, mental is on the lower level, verbal is on a higher level, physical offense is on the highest level. So accordingly reactions are also like that. Now text 26 to 30 is Guna Kirtana. Generally we do Nama Kirtan of Lord's holy names. This is called Guna Kirtana, describing the wonderful qualities of the Lord. So Dharani is remembering the Lord in terms of his qualities. Satyam shaucham daya kshanti stiyaga santosha arjavam shamodamastapasamyam titiksho paratishrutam jnanam virakti raishvaryam shauryam tejo balam smrutihi svatantryam kaushalam kantir mardavam dhairyam mardavam evacha प्रागल्भ्यं प्रश्रयशीलं सह ओजो बलं भगः गांभीर्यस्थैर्यमास्तिक्यं कीर्तिमानो अनहंकृतिः एते चान्ये च भगवान् नित्यायत्र महागुणाः प्रार्थ्या महत्वमिच्छद्भिर्नवीयन्ति स्म कर्हिचित् तेनाहं गुणपात्रेण श्रीनिवासेन साम्प्रतं शोचामि रहितं लोकं पाप्मनाकादिनेक्षितम्. So I'll read the translations in the word to word till certain point of time, and then I'll read from the translation. So Satyam, truthfulness, Shaucham, cleanliness, Daya, intolerance of others' unhappiness, Kshantihi, self-control, even if there is a cause of anger, Tyagaha, magnanimity, Santoshaha, self-satisfaction, Arjavam, straightforwardness, Shamaha, fixing the mind, Damaha, controlling the sense organs, Tapaha is an interesting translation, trueness to one's responsibility, this is called Tapasya, Samyam, indiscrimination between friend and foe, Titiksha, tolerance of the offense of others, Uparatihi, indifference to loss and gain, Shrutam, following scriptural injunctions or judging things according to scriptures. Jnanam, knowledge, self-realization. Viraktihi, detachment from sense enjoyment or absence of taste of sense enjoyment. Aishwaryam, leadership. Shauryam, chivalry. Tejaha, influence. Balam, to render possible that which is impossible. Smrutihi, to find one's proper duty. Interesting, huh? Smrutihi, to find one's proper duty and act accordingly. Svatantriyam, not to depend on others. Kaushalam, dexterity in all activities. Kantihi, beauty. Dhairyam, freedom from disturbance. Mardavam, kind-heartedness. Eva, thus. Pragalbhyam, ingenuity. Prashrayaha, gentility. Shilam, mannerliness. Sahaha, sahan karna, determination. Ojaha, perfect knowledge. Balam, proper execution. Bhagaha, object of enjoyment. Gambhiryam, joyfulness. Interesting. Again, generally say gambhir means very grave. Bhruha gambhir means joyful. Sthairyam, immovability. Astikyam, faithfulness. Kirtihi, fame. manaha worthy of being worshipped, yet anahankritihi pridelessness. Yetecha anyecha, these are also many other qualities, are possessed by the Supreme Lord. So I'm reading from the translation. So point 38, pridelessness, 39, being as personality of Godhead, and 40, eternity, nityaha, everlastingness, and many other transcendental qualities which are eternally present and never to be separated from Him. That personality of Godhead, the reservoir of all goodness and beauty, Lord Shri Krishna, has now closed His transcendental pastimes on the face of the earth. In His absence, the age of Kali has spread its influence everywhere. So I am sorry to see this condition of existence. So what are the two reasons? Lord has closed His transcendental pastimes, and in His absence, Kali has spread influence everywhere. So I'll read bits and pieces in the purport. So Prabhupada first talks about how it is impossible to glorify the Lord in terms of how many qualities can he possess. Even Antashesh cannot count all His qualities. Then some 10th line. According to Srila Jiva Goswami, the third quality, daya, intolerance of another's unhappiness, can be subdivided into two: protection of surrendered souls and well wishes for the devotees. That is daya. Little later, by quality 10, samya, the Lord is equally kind to everyone, as sun is equal in distributing its rays over everyone. Last line, He appears to be partial to His devotees, but factually the matter rests on the living being to accept or reject equal treatment by the Lord. A very nice way of putting it. Samoham sarvabhuteshu name dveshosti na priyaha ye bhajanti tumam bhaktya mai te teshu chapiyaham. Now comes the description of tapaha, the next two paragraphs almost. The Lord never deviates from His word of honor. When He gives assurance for protection, the promise is executed in all circumstances. It is the duty of the pure devotee to be fixed in the discharge of the duty entrusted to him, or the Lord's bona fide representative, either given to him by the Lord or Lord's representative, the spiritual master. The rest is carried on by the Lord without a break. That line is very nice. The rest is carried on by the Lord without a break. So which means we have to get clear instructions from Krishna or Guru on how should we organize our day-to-day affairs and simply stick to that duty very nicely. What are the goals to be achieved and what are the means through which we should achieve them? That clarity has to be there. Sadhya sadhana nirnay. And after that, one should simply dedicate oneself to dutifully executing those instructions. Then what happens? The Lord carries on the rest without a break. So other things manifest. The responsibility of the Lord is also unique. The Lord has no responsibility because all His work is done by different appointed energies. But still He accepts voluntary responsibilities in displaying different roles in His transcendental pastimes. So as a boy, He becomes cowherd boy. You know, as a kshatriya, He has to secure a wife by fighting or kidnapping. So He does it. Interesting responsibility. Huh? Even Ram broke the bow called Haradhanur, achieved the hand of Sita Devi, the mother of all opulence. So Lord doesn't need to all that, but He displays all the Kshatriya spirit, the Vaishya spirit, whatever that He takes on as a role. So to fight 16,000 times to secure 16,000 wives is certainly possible only for the Supreme Personality of Godhead. He displayed full responsibility in every action of his different transcendental pastimes. What Prabhupada must be relishing, huh? And he writes something. Very interesting. Then comes Shrutam. The 14th quality in knowledge can be further divided into 5 subheadings. Intelligence, gratefulness. Interesting, huh? That is also intelligence, being grateful. Power of understanding the circumstantial environments of time, place, circumstance. Place, object and time. Perfect knowledge of everything and knowledge of the self. So this is education, in short. If somebody develops these qualities, he is educated. Only fools are ungrateful to their benefactors. So to the degree that Lord is grateful to his devotees. So that theme continues. Lord's gratitude. And then next paragraph is Kanti. As far as the beauty is concerned, he has some special features that distinguish him from all other living entities. And over and above that, he has some special attractive, beautiful features by which he attracts the mind of even Radharani. The supermost beautiful creation of the Lord. Very interesting. See, Radharani is the supermost beautiful creation of the Lord. Now she comes from Krishna. But to attract her mind, Krishna has to exhibit something special. Only then she can get attracted to him, you know. So this is called rasa. This is like, this goes beyond logic actually. In the sense that, okay, if something came from the Lord, then it always remains subservient or subordinate to the Lord, right? How can that have an expectation from the Lord to excel than who he already is, so that the subset is charmed by the superset? Hare Krishna. So interesting. Then Prabhupada talks about how knowledge of the Lord is ever fixed and unfathomable. That's the theme. And Prabhupada says, living beings can appreciate the qualities of the Lord as the ultimate goal, but they cannot attain the status quo of such equality. See, all of us, when we read these qualities, we feel, I should have had them, you know. How nice it would have been if I had all these qualities in full. How nice I would be. No, we feel like that. But we can never equal the Lord in terms of these qualities. We can only have a drop of them. Now, the Lord is independent and fully control, has full control over everything. So that is explained in a little later. This material world is a product of Mahatattva, which is a state of Lord's dreaming condition in his Yoga Nidra, mystic slumber, in the causal ocean. And yet the whole creation appears to be factual representation of his creation. This means that the Lord's dreaming conditions are also factual manifestations. Interesting. He can therefore bring everything under his transcendental control. Thus, whenever and wherever he does appear, he does so in his fullness. See, sometimes when we dream, the dream is not real. And we can't control the dream, both. But for the Lord, that is not the case. His supreme controller means including what happens in the dream, that also he controls. So Prabhupada says this is called full control of the Lord. I like the next line very much. The Lord, being all that is described above, maintains the affairs of the creation. So such a Lord who has these qualities, you know, Satyam, Shaucham, Daya, Kshanti, Stiyagaha, Santosham, Arjavam, Shamaha, Damaha, Tapaha, Samyam. Such a Lord is maintaining the affairs of the creation. Thank God. Huh? It's not some Hitler or it's not some point singularity. It is not some crazy thing that is maintaining this world. Lord with such qualities, okay, He is maintaining the creation. So thank God. No? And He is what kind of person? He gives salvation even to His enemies. He is attractive even to the topmost liberated souls who are not attracted to anything. And He is worshipable even by Brahma and Shiva, the greatest of all demigods. So then Prabhupada describes avatars, Purusha avatara, Manvantara avatara, some of them. He is the root cause of innumerable incarnations. Now, interesting line it is, there are more than 500,000 incarnations of Manu. Now, these are not incarnations of Manu, they are Manvantara avatars. Okay, you get the difference? Manu is not incarnating, Lord is incarnating in the Manvantaras. So that's why incarnations of Manu. Where did Prabhupada get that number from? 5 lakh incarnation. So there are in one day of Brahma 14 Manus, and you multiply that by 30 into 12 into 100. So you get number. So in one day of Brahma, one lifespan of Brahma, so many 5 lakh, you know, Manvantara avatars come. Can you imagine 5 lakh avatars come in one lifespan of Brahma? In our lifespan, not much, okay? But in Brahmadeva's lifespan, 5 lakh incarnations come. This is just Manvantara avatars. How many other incarnations come and go? So that means Lord in the sense is constantly in touch with the material world, you know, to save those conditioned souls and take them back, you know. He is periodically, I wouldn't say even periodically, He is rapidly, you know, going and coming back in the material world to catch some conditioned souls and take them back to Godhead. So that is what Prabhupada is saying. In the spiritual world, which is beyond Mahatattva, there is no question of incarnations. There are planetary expansions. Planets in the spiritual sky are at least 3 times the number of those within the Mahatattva. All the Narayana forms are but expansions of Vasudeva feature. And thus, He is Vasudeva, Narayana, Krishna simultaneously. And then Prabhupada quotes what He has told us not to sing. He is Shri Krishna Govinda Hare Murare He Nath Narayana Vasudeva. So this is typically sung by Mayavadis, impersonalists. And this song is not allowed to be sung in ISKCON, for your information, FYI. But He is quoting to the Mayavadis that you sing this song, right? This is what it means, okay? Now follow Krishna consciousness. That's the, you know, His qualities. Sorry, so He is Shri Krishna Govinda Hare Murare He Nath Narayana Vasudeva, all in one. Okay? His qualities therefore cannot be counted by anyone, however great one may be. Hare Krishna. Quite a big and nice purport. I would request you to please later on once again go back and pay attention to the word to word translations. Very interesting. You know, sometimes we think that we understand some quality, okay? Or we understand some whatever description. But you read it in a context, you say, wow, this I never knew. Pragalbhya means ingenuity. Pragalbhata. And prashraya means gentility. Uparati means indifference to loss and gain. Uparati Mataji. Then Kaushalam, dexterity in all activities. Dhairya means freedom from all disturbance. And Gambhirya was too good. Joyfulness. Gambhir. Gambhir means aisa kyun muh latka ke baitha hai. It's not like that. Internally is very joyful. Externally is very grave. Kripalu akruta droha, in that also. Gambhira karuna maitra. Okay. Any comments, questions? Text 31. Atmanam na chanu shochami. Bhavantam jamaruttamam. Devan pitrun drushin sadhun. Sarvan varanan stathashraman. Translation.
I am thinking about myself and also O best among the demigods, about you, as well as about all the demigod sages, dungeons of Pitruloka, devotees of the Lord and men, obedient to the system of Varna and Ashrama in human society.
So in the previous verse there was this word Tena Rahitam. Because my surface has become devoid of Lord's presence, so that Tena Rahitam continues in this verse also. All these that are devoid of the Lord, I am lamenting their condition. So there is an integrated system in the universe. What is that integrated system? So there is the Lord, and then there are devatas, then there are forefathers, pitrus, then there are rishis, sages, then there are sadhus, and then there are human beings who are following Varnashrama system. So Prabhupada says there is a life of cooperation between all of them. So everyone cooperates with everyone else, and this is how ekameka saihya karu avagedharu supantha. So they flourish by the such cooperation. The distinction between human life and animal life therefore begins with the scientific system of Varna and Ashrama, guided by the experience of sages. Gradually rising to the summit of re-establishing our eternal relationship with the Supreme Absolute Truth, Krishna. When God made Varnashram Dharma, which is strictly meant for developing animal consciousness into human consciousness, and human consciousness into godly consciousness, is broken by the advancement of foolishness. Interesting, huh? The whole system of peaceful and progressive life is at once disturbed. So that famous BTJ article, advanced in foolishness. What is this whole modern civilization? Advanced in foolishness. Gadvanchi Pragati, you know, in Marathi. So Prabhupada then talks about how Brahmana is not a birthright claim. It is by qualities and activities that you become a Brahman. And then he gives a punch at the end. In the present age, consideration of the necessary qualification is being neglected. The false birthright claim is being supported even by a popular sophisticated poet, the author of Ramacharitmanas. It seems that he supported birthright claim that Brahman's son can become Brahman and Shudra's son has to remain Shudra. Such a learned person, but he can get carried away. So I have the line, exact line that he quotes. Puja hu vipra shila guna vihina, puja hu shudra na guna vihina. So which means, main us vipra ki puja karta hu jo shila guna se vihin hai, lekin main us shudra ki puja nahi karunga jo guno se yukta hai. So that's a line in some of his writings. I really went and found it out. Why Prabhupada is saying this? You know, and Prabhupada knows a lot. Huh? Sometimes we tend to think, "Arey, we don't read other things, you know. So what do we know about those cultures and those, you know, saints and those personalities?" But Prabhupada knows. So you don't have to worry about that part. You don't know, no problem. Your teacher knows. This is all due to the influence of age of Kali. Thus, Mother Earth, represented as a cow, was lamenting the regrettable condition. Yes. That's why Prabhupada is quoting. So on one side, we respect all saints and sages, but we also mention where something goes off. Yeah. Yeah.
So many quotes actually they quote, and some is true.
Well, there is a big debate going on in ISKCON about this, that how much of Ramcharitmanas can be studied and quoted by the devotees. And there are devotees who produce evidences on either side. There are devotees who produce evidence that it should not be done. And there are people who say that, oh, it can be done in a particular context. That we accept Tulsidas as Vaishnava, but who had a tinge of impersonalistic writing once in a while in his presentation. So there are both sides to the story. Yes. Yes. So our point is this: when it comes to public discourses, we should quote what Prabhupada taught and our acharyas have emphasized. When it comes to private discussions amongst qualified, sincere, practicing devotees, we may sometimes relish, like Prabhupada relishes, you know, Sri Vaishnava, you know, some verses, or Prabhupada may relish. So that's not, we are not like anti everything, you know. But there is a way, there is a presentation. Those people, they have not yet generated their Shraddha in Krishna consciousness, pure Krishna consciousness. And we are trying to give them too much, you know, variety to chew in their head. So first some Shraddha, then some practice, then some relish, eventually. So the next verse talks about how Earth is actually lamenting that she was at the peak of her good fortune, to the extent that her opulence was much beautiful, bigger, better than that of the opulence of the three worlds, because of Krishna's presence on Earth. And then Earth is thinking, because I became proud of my position, Krishna went away. You know, and thus I have been made bereft of all good fortune. So that is her lamentation. So that is expressed in this verse. Brahmadayo bahutitham yadapanga moksha. Kamastapas samacharan bhagavat prapanna. Sashri swavasamaravindavanam vihaya. Yatpada saubhagamalam bhajate nurakta. Tasyaham abjakulishan kushake tuketai. Srimat padair bhagavata sabalam krutangri. Trinatya rocha upalabhyatato vibhutim. Lokan samam vyasrujat utsmayati tadante. Translation.
Lakshmi, the goddess of fortune, whose glance of grace was sought by the demigods in Brahma, and for whom they surrendered many a day unto the prosperity of Godhead, gave up their own abode in the forest of lotus flowers and engaged herself in the service of the lotus people to God. I was endowed with specific powers to supersede the fortune of all the three planetary systems, being decorated with the impressions of the black, underworld, elephant driving rod, and lotus flower, which are signs of the lotus feet of the Lord. But at the end, when I was afraid, I was so fortunate, the lotus god, the Lord left me.
So the last line is Utsmayantim, while feeling proud, Visrujat, he gave me up. At what peak point he gave me up? Tadante, at the end of what exactly? Trin Ati Aroche, Upalabhyatataha Vibhutim. So I got opulences that are greater than the three worlds. And I had vibhutis, which are very specific powers given to me, which even they did not have, those lokas did not have. So I became proud, and the Lord left me. So she is lamenting for that reason. So this is her real misery. In the 33rd verse, she is explaining. And then she is creating a background for that lamentation. She gives the example that Brahma Adayaha, means all devatas, including Lord Brahma, Bahutitham, for a long, long time, they are desiring Lakshmi's Apanga Moksha, a glance, sidelong glance of favor upon themselves. And with that desire, Kamaha Tapaha Samacharan Bhagavat Prapannaha, remaining sheltered in the lotus feet of the Lord, they are desiring that when will Lakshmi ji glance upon us and make us fortunate in life. And that Lakshmi, Sa Shri, what she is doing, Swavasam Aravindavanam Vihaya, giving up her own abode in the lotus jungle, Aravindavanam, where she stays, that's the name of her place, okay, abode, Aravindavana. She is running after Yat Pada Saubhagamalam Bhajate. She is running after the lotus feet of the Lord with the hope that someday, you know, I will attain them. And what was my fortune? Those lotus feet of the Lord never failed to make an imprint on me. See, sometimes the queens of the Lord or even Lakshmi doesn't get the association of the Lord when he's on some business. But Mother Earth is never devoid of touch of Krishna at any given point of time. So that was my good fortune, which was not the good fortune of even Goddess of Fortune. So this is what she is describing as a background. Okay, how fortunate I was. And now I have lost this situation, so I am very, very miserable. So Ketaha means impressions. Ketu Ketaha. Purport. The beauty and opulence of the world can be enhanced by the grace of the Lord and not by any man-made planning. So Prabhupada gives the example, when Krishna was on the earth, when his foot impressions marked on the earth, everything flourished. Rivers, seas, forests, hills, mines. They were supplying agents for the necessities of men and animals. They were fully discharging the respective duties by the presence of the Lord. Therefore, the riches of the world surpassed all the riches of all other planets. Means Prithvi Loka became more rich than other planets. One should, conclusion, therefore ask that the grace of the Lord always be present on earth, so that we may be favored with His causeless mercy and happy, having all necessities of life. Now someone may say, but Lord went, no? I think we should have detained Him by telling Him some stories, you know, that, you know, you should not go, you know, you should stay here only now. So Prabhupada answers that mentality. One may ask, how we can detain the Supreme Lord on this earth after His mission is fulfilled and He has left this earth for His own abode? The answer is that there is no need to detain the Lord. The Lord, being omnipresent, can be present with us if we want Him at all. By His omnipresence, He can always be with us if we are attached to His devotional service by hearing, chanting, remembering, etc. There is nothing in the world with which the Lord is disconnected. The only thing we must learn is to excavate the source of connection. Prabhupada is in this. Excavate the source of connection and thus be linked with Him by offenseless service. We can be connected with Him by the transcendental sound representation of the Lord. Holy name and Lord are identical. So amazing, huh? How can you detain the Lord? Okay. So this is the method. Excavate the source of connection and be linked with Him through offenseless service and by transcendental sound. So, then Prabhupada gives an analogy. Even by the vibration of radio sound, we can partially realize sound relativity. And by resounding the sound of transcendence, we can verily feel the presence of the Lord. So, because in the Kali Yuga everything is contaminated, Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu told, chant Hare Krishna. So, by chanting, we can at once be free from contamination, gradually rise to the status of transcendence and go back to Godhead. Now comes the mood and mission that Prabhupada wants to offer us. The offenseless chanter of the holy name of the Lord is as auspicious as the Lord Himself. And the movement of pure devotee of the Lord all over the world can at once change the troublesome face of the world. Only by the propagation of the chanting of the holy name of the Lord can we be immune from all effects of the age of Kali. So we may be in Kali Yuga but not affected by it, provided we perform offenseless loud sankirtan. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Ram, Hare Ram, Ram Ram, Hare Hare. Achha, achha, achha. Okay, we'll complete this chapter and then see. So, you know, the mood is, Dharani, she is saying that the Lord marked my body with the beautiful auspicious impressions of His lotus feet. You know what I did? She is saying in this verse. Like a sindoor that is preserved by a chaste lady, I preserved these footprints of the Lord from rain and also from others trampling. That much she likes, you know, having those impressions on her surface. And after that, if the Lord leaves, you know how much misery you will feel. Okay, text 34. And now, having remembered the Lord's footprints on her, she is also recollecting, why did the Lord traverse the earth here and there? It is simply to subdue the demoniac forces and to make dharma rejuvenated. Paripranaya sadhunam vinashaya dharma samsthapanarthaya. He walked everywhere. So that's the mood. Yo vai mamati bharama suravamsharadnyam akshauhini shatamapanu dadatma tantra tvam dusthamunapada Atmani Paurushena sampadayan yadushuramyam abhibhatrangam sampadayan yadushuramyam abhibhrat angam Translation.
The personal relation, I was greatly overburdened by the undue military balances arranged by atheistic kings, and I was relieved by the grace of the personality provided. Similarly, you were also in a distressed condition, weakened in your standing strength, and thus he also incarnated by his internal energy in the family of the Edus to relieve you.
So you see, the Sanskrit as a language, you don't say handicapped. You are handicapped. Divyanga. So it's eulogy actually. False eulogy. There is a unapada. Unapada means someone devoid of strength to stand. The language is so sweet. Means he has at such potential as a jiva, his atma, part and parcel of Krishna. Currently, he is devoid of doing this activity. So, unapada. And this asura vamsha radnyam can also mean there were previous kings in the demoniac dynasties who had taken birth on earth also. And they were killed by Krishna. So, Asura Vamsha Radnya. Purport. The Asuras want to enjoy a life of sense gratification even at the cost of others' happiness. So they equip themselves with deadly weapons. They have no ambition other than personal aggrandizement. They follow by increase of them, Asuric population, those who follow the principles of religion become unhappy. And so the Lord incarnates. Text 35. This is the most important and sweet verse of this whole chapter. Kava saheta viraham purushottamasya premavaloka ruchirasmitaval gujalpaihi stairyam samana maharan madhumaninam Romotsavo mama yadangri vitankitaya. Translation.
Who therefore can forbid the times of separation from the Supreme Personality of Godhead? He could conquer the gravity and passion of wrath of his sweet heart's light. Satyamama by his sweet smile of love, pleasing glance and hearty appeal.
Chai. Hearty appeal.
Earth's surface. I would be immersed in the dust of his lotus feet and thus would be sumptuously covered with grass which appeared like hairs standing on me out of view.
So first of all, Lord is Purushottama, best of all persons that you can come in touch with. Who can tolerate viraha from him? Ka va saheta viraham? That's a question being asked. Who can tolerate separation from Krishna? What is the speciality? There are ladies who have two qualities, sthairya and mana. They are very fixed, sthira, and they have tremendous pride of their beauty or whatever. So, these ladies are sometimes unconquerable by any kind of ordinary men. So, madhumani ninam. But Lord conquered them. Okay, so Prithvi Dharani, she is also one of the queens of the Lord, Bhudevi. So she is comparing herself and those ladies, you know, that our condition in connection with the Lord. So how did the Lord conquer them? Prema avaloka. Sometimes simply by one loving glance, He would conquer them. Nothing more has to be done. No talk, no, you know, gifts, no, you know, nothing. Then ruchira smita. Sometimes He gives a very attractive smile. And finally, valgu jalpa. Now Krishna is Veda Vakta. You know, He speaks the Vedas. Who can, He's called Priyamvada, a sweet talker. He can talk anything, His way out of anything. You know, so when He speaks, it is called Shruti Manohara. You know, His language is so charming, so attractive to the consciousness that people just fall flat after hearing what He speaks. So generally, only Krishna could conquer such ladies. Otherwise, they are unconquerable by anybody. It's not like Cleopatra and some other ladies that we have heard of, you know. These ladies are, you know. So, such a Lord who had such wonderful qualities. So, Madhumanini Naam refers to Krishna's sweethearts. Like the Satyabhama. What is her speciality? Manini. Manini means she has great mana that she can keep for a long time. You know? So, passionate wrath, Prabhupada says. Mana means, interesting translation that is. Passionate wrath. You know. So Krishna, you know, one time Radharani, she is waiting for him. And he, as usual, he goes to meet Chandravali. Comes very late. Radharani is so upset. She is not even looking at him. So Krishna is talking, Valgu Jalpa. He says, I can lift Govardhan Hill. That doesn't make me feel any burden. But your man is unbearable for me. Radharani is like, you know, all the more upset, you know, with all this kind of talk. So, one time they are talking to each other, and Krishna is appreciating Srimati Radharani. He says that, oh, your toenails, they are shining like a moon, like 10 moons. Radharani becomes upset. Acha, that means you are thinking of Chandravali. moon row, you know, 10 moons. Krishna, what is this? No connection. You know. And then Krishna says, well, then she asks, so where were you? Tell me. No, I didn't go to Chandravali, he says. Then you tell me, where were you? He said, main Giriraj ki kasam kha ke kehta hoon, Braj Raj ki kasam kha ke kehta hoon, Goraj ki kasam kha ke kehta hoon, itna kya main apne aap ki kasam kha ke kehta hoon. So when Krishna is saying that, Radharani puts her hand on his mouth and she says, "Arey, jhoot bol, magar apni kasam khakar kam se kam mat bol." Itna sara bol raha hai, theek hai. You know, iska kasam, uska kasam. So she can't tolerate, you know, Krishna taking jhooti kasam in his own name. She knows that he has gone. But, you know, so out of her love, she stops him. She says, "Apni kasam kam se kam khake mat bol." So this is called as Shruti Manohara. You know, Krishna's pastimes are so maddening in terms of Valgu Jalpa. And you can imagine if you get to talk to Krishna, what that would be, huh? And Prabhupada says the goal of our religious practice ultimately to go shake hands with God and talk to Him. You know, and serve Him nicely, you know, one to one, personally. So this is what we are offering, you know, not something small. And purport. There were chances of separation between the Lord and His thousands of queens because the Lord is being absent from home. But as far as His connection with earth was concerned, what is the line? Roma utsavaha mama yadangri vitankitaya. The Lord would traverse the earth with His lotus feet and therefore there was no chance of separation. When the Lord left the surface of the earth to return to His spiritual abode, the earth's feeling of separation were therefore more acute. So, तयोरेव कथम यत् कथयतो पृथिवी धर्मयोस्तदा परीक्षिन्नाम राजर्षिः प्राप्तः प्राचीं सरस्वतीम्. ट्रांसलेशन.
The scene-taking Parikshit reached the shore of Saraswati River, which flowed towards the east.
So, tayoreva kathayato. They were talking, conversing with each other. Purthvi and Dharmaha. Parikshin nama Rajarshi praptaha. He arrived. Where was this place? Yeah, Saraswati is flowing. Now it is not seen, Saraswati river, Ganga Yamuna Saraswati Visena. They meet at Prayag. So that means Saraswati starts somewhere in, I don't know where exactly, some Sindh region. And from there she flows towards east, towards Yamuna and Ganga. Any other? So maybe we should just take quickly the note of next chapter's sections so that we can just directly start the chapter. So chapter 17, punishment and reward of Kali. So 16 verses beginning. Parikshit Maharaj, as an ideal king, appropriately chastises Kali. Parikshit Maharaj discusses cause of suffering of Dharani and Dharma. He asks them, why are you suffering? 28-41. Parikshit Maharaj expertly gives residence to the ironically surrendered Kali. He is showing surrender, but is not. He expertly gives residence to ironically surrendered Kali. And 42-45, glorious rule of Parikshit Maharaj. So because Prabhu asked the question, I'll talk. Last time we discussed Brazil, right?
No, we didn't discuss.
You said next time. Achha. Where did I? Oh, in Bhakti Shastri class I know. Okay. So this whole foreign visit thing began originally when His Holiness Radhanath Maharaj was talking to few of us in Vada GEV, where repeated requests were coming from different devotees that first of all for the training and education of existing devotees, and then to also stabilize the outreach events of ISKCON and devotee care systems. There is a great deal of great need of, you know, preachers, caregivers kind of in ISKCON. So the 2-3 particular devotees who are inviting, they are specifically inviting me, but they are making a point that there is a generic need for these things there. So then Maharaj said, why don't you go? I said, I said, I'm happy with whatever service I have, but if this is what you, so how much should I go? I asked. I said, go some, whatever time permits. Maharaj never says any specific. And then I talked to these devotees. Their first trip that they planned was 45 days, so that became a tradition. That 45 days a year. So then this time when I went, that was more to do with 15 days of GBC college. So this was a service that came through ISKCON's Leadership Development Sangha, not ILS, GBC college. So the purpose of GBC college is to train all different cadres of devotees in ISKCON. ISKCON Leadership Sangha is to just get together all the leaders for Sangha and some common announcements and cultural engineering of the whole ISKCON community. GBC College is focused on training varieties of cadres of leaders in ISKCON. So we typically have entry level group leaders, teachers, educators, Shiksha Diksha Guru, Sannyasis. So that's the Shiksha line. And then there is the administrative line of ISKCON. You become a department head, project leader, like a temple president, farm community owner, national council member, zonal supervisor, global duty officer, GBC. So, three reasons. Number one is to train. Number two is to certify, assess and certify the quality. And number three is to then appoint such trained leaders. Currently, people become leaders because of they are the only ones there that existed in that, you know, that's that community or all. And many times they themselves don't get trained because they are so busy doing service, there is no time for self-development for them. So GBC College is trying to reach out to this various areas and offer this service. My main interest in this was curriculum design, more than just going and giving classes, because if the, what they call, the matrix of the, what they call, threadbare structure of the whole thing is very nicely done, then anybody can teach, that's not a problem. But it is having some susutrata, there's a gradual development of leadership. So that was my main interest, curriculum design. So this is how I got into this. Then in Brazil we have three places where I visited: Sao Paulo, Campina Grande, Caruaru. So Sao Paulo is having something like a voice base structure. No, nobody speaks English. All Spanish and Portuguese. This is another thing I observed. Only in India hum English ko ghas dalte hai. Baki duniya mein koi ghas nahi dalta. English is not a thing, you know, for many people. They just don't, they're not undervalued, they just don't consider it as a something that exists on the planet. So, you know, so we are so subjugated in our slave mentality still. Anyways, so Spanish and Portuguese is the only language. And even I give class, they translate. And there are people who know English, but they don't speak English. They will speak in Spanish only. So that's the culture. So Sao Paulo has an interesting community, maybe 300-400 devotees. And that day when I went was Ram Navami, Ramachandra appearance day. So I landed up in the temple and I got to know a lot of their culture. This is more like Bombay, you know, similar buildings and everything. And the whole cricket, this is like cricket mania here, the football mania there. Everybody is mad after football. So I was passing through and there were stadiums where football match was even now going where. And the rousing sound of public, you know. Oh my God, you can hear it at far distance. It, from the whole stadium is reverberating, you know, like that. I was thinking how nice if you chant Hare Krishna like this. Powerful, this view. And then Sao Paulo has a very small base type structure, picture altar, simple arrangement. Three boys, one old Mataji, Prabhupada disciple, and one Bhakta John, who came to pick me up. So these are five people who stay there, and they run the whole center. And they have another farm community nearby. It's called Nava Vrindavan, I think. So they have this mostly Sunday feast program, which gets full audience, but other times not much happens. And from Sao Paulo, I went to Campina Grande. There are two universities in the middle of which Dhanvantari Swami has taken a beautiful patch of land. Half patch of land he has given to Grihasthas to make their own houses. From the profits that got generated, another half patch of land is converted into a resort, classrooms, Govindas, swimming pool, and educational facility, basically. Nice idea. So no fundraising required. So everything got adjusted within that. And most of them are like teachers, professors, you know, like that. So education is not a problem for them. So they run one Jaladuta Institute, which is a very famous Spanish wing of ISKCON's training education program, Bhakti Shastri, Bhakti Vaibhav, IDC, teacher training course, all online. So they run that, and some is on ground also. People come to their place and take training. They have very nice program. And there is a small temple, half of this room size temple, where there is deities of Mahagaur Nithai. They are 6 feet tall, beautiful deities. And the best part of their community was their morning program. 4:30 Mangal Arati, 5 o'clock Shloka recitation, 5:05 Bhagavatam class, 35 minutes class, 5 minutes Jai Radha Madhav, 30 minutes talk. And their justification is Prabhupada never gave classes more than 25-30 minutes. Why are we giving? And then 5:40 is Japa. And 7:30 is Darshanarthi and Guru Puja. 7:45 morning program ends. Everything done. And they are Grihastha devotees, so they go for their jobs and this and that. Everything is done. What a nice arrangement. I liked it. And if somebody woke up late, still they can come for Japa at least, 5:40. You know, and somebody has to go early, they can leave any time in between, 6:30, 7, 7:15, no problem. Because most of their Japa is also done. So it's a nice educationist type arrangement by Dhanvantari Swami. This is one thing I liked. No, 5:40 to 7:30, 1 hour, 50 minutes. Oh, in Mangal Arati, yes. It's a 15-minute, 16-minute Mangal Arati, not 25 minutes. And of course, then they have Narasimha Arati, Tulsi Puja. And they just don't sing all the time. Of course, they sing Chetodarpana Marjanam, but their thrust is also on reciting other verses. So they take for a month 15 chapter of the Gita, another time some Bhagavatam, you know, set of 10 verses. So what happens, you do it day by day, that's done, you know, for life. You know that series. So like this. Classes are all in Spanish. So I used to chant 20 rounds because I don't understand everything that go chant in that time. Prasadam is too good. Brazil is like all natural resources and vegetables and fruits and unlimited quantity you get it. Sattvic, so sattvic, after coming from there, my stomach couldn't handle this prasadam that we ate. You know, I became sattvic. So, anyways, so another time we will describe further. Thank you very much. Srila Prabhupada ki jai.